Good morning. Welcome to worship this morning with Montrose United Methodist Church. I'm Brittany Baer, our Director of Spiritual Formation. I am glad to see all of you here this morning. One announcement we have is that the Montrose United Methodist Church t-shirts are available in Baldridge Hall. Brian will be in there with them between the services, so if you'd like to get one, they'll be over there. And then Annie also has an announcement this morning.
I don't think it was you.
Thank you, Brittany. I just want to say a word about the walk to Emmaus. Some of you may know a little bit about that. Some of you may know a lot about it. Several members of our congregation have gone on this retreat. It's coming up soon, and we're going to be having information out in the emails and so on very quickly for you. But I just wanted to say a word about it. This coming Saturday, we're going to have a information session downstairs in room one. We'll have a video. We'll have some folks there that have been on the walk to Emmaus before to answer your questions and tell you a little bit more about it. Some of us are working those walks, and so we'll be there, and we just hope to see some of you there as well. I'll be sending information out this week. Thank you.
We are people of the Word.
And today the Word that we have heard is Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed.
We are a people of the world.
And today our world is in need of peace.
We are a people of work.
And today our work is laid aside so that we might find rest for our souls.
We are a people of worship.
And today we offer our worship in the spirit of humble gratitude and joy.
As grace rises, we are able for our opening song. Here I am to worship. You will find this in the green songbook. Page number is 3177.
Open my eyes, let me see.
Good morning. I am the ministry moment again today for Vacation Bible School. And here in a minute, we have another cute video to watch for you guys. But Vacation Bible School is coming up really quick. Registration is open for kids and for volunteers. This year's theme is scuba. It is underwater themed. And we are diving into friendship with God. So June 3rd through 7th in the mornings, 9 to 12:15, we'll be here in the church having all of our programs. And we still need some volunteers. So I'm going to have Steve play our next video here.
Hey, there's only one spot left.
For what?
For the VBS sign-up.
I wanted to sign up for that. Could you take me? Church is real close.
It's all mine, buddy.
Come on. Open it up.
Took the last spot on the volunteer sign-up sheet.
Oh no, there's always more room for volunteers at VBS. Should we tell him?
Nah.
Would you join me in reading the prayer for illumination? God, as we look into the pages of Holy Scripture, let us not dismiss the word that you've already given to us, but open our hearts to the new word you may speak to us today. We pray in your holy name. Amen. The New Testament lesson today. The next day, their rulers, elders, and scribes assembled in Jerusalem with Annas the high priest, Caiaphas, John, and Alexander, and all who were of the high priest family. When they had made the prisoners stand in their midst, they inquired, "By what power or by what name did you do this?" Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, "Rulers of the people and elders, if we are questioned today because of a good deed done to someone who was sick and are asked how this man has been healed, let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that this man is standing before you in good health by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead. This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders. It has become the cornerstone. There is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among mortals by which we must be saved. The word of God for the people of God.
You guys gonna come join me? Alright. Maybe? We'll see. Alright, we'll do it anyway. Alright. So boys, have you met my puppet yet? So this is Star. Everybody's met him here a little bit. And he likes to squawk. Ready? Okay? And our story today, actually, you guys will relate to a little bit. So do you guys like your home? Yeah? What makes it special? That's okay, you don't have to answer it. So my favorite thing in my house that makes my house special is my room, is my bed. That's my favorite spot. Okay? Do you guys think, and I know you guys have gone through this, but do you think you'll ever have to live in another place? You guys have moved, haven't you? So you guys know about living in a different place. Some kids don't ever get to experience that. So our homes are more than just this little space where we can plop down. I think about our home as being on planet Earth. How do we treat our home? Nicely, right? Sometimes people take their shoes off at the door. They do chores. They put away their toys in the right places, help with the yard work, sometimes help your parents fix the things that get broken. Yeah. Sometimes we put out decorations and different things. Do you think we can do the same kind of things no matter where we are thinking of being home? Yeah. What if our home was the whole planet? Do you think you would take off your shoes when you go in the door of the planet? Or put out holiday decorations for the whole planet? Maybe. That's kind of silly, isn't it? So how do we take care of our home? What things can we do for our planet? Keep it clean. We can keep things out of the landfills. We can use reusable items. Okay? We can make a lot of different choices, right? So I want to teach you guys a saying about how to live from our church's history. And it goes like this: do all the good you can by all the means you can, in all the ways you can, in all the places you can, at all the times you can, to all the people you can, as long as you ever can. There's also a Bible verse from Mark chapter 12, verses 30 and 31, that talks about loving your neighbor as yourself. When we think about doing all the good we can and loving our neighbors throughout the whole planet, how can we live like that? We can live like that by caring about other people, sharing our stuff, helping those in need, and so on. Will you guys all join me in our repeat after me prayer? God of love, God of justice, God of wisdom, thank you for loving us so much that you made us part of this great big planet with all our neighbors. Teach us to do all the good we can by all the means we can, in all the places we can, at all the times we can, to all the people we can, as long as ever we can. Amen. All right, you guys can grab your kids' bulletin if you want one.
Just in case you're wondering, I'm not trying to play a game of who's that preacher. I am on the recovery side of the flu and hoping to do everything that I can do not to bless you with that same virus. So it's good to see everyone this morning. Here's the scene. There are two strangers sitting at a tiny table in this bustling coffee house on the Bay of Bengal. they're sipping coffee and talking to each other in the casual way of strangers. The old man, who's a native of the region, tells the other, who is a really stressed out Canadian writer, "I have a story that will make you believe in God." Does anyone recognize that scene? This is how the life of Pi begins, which is Jan Martel's really fantastic metaphorical book about faith and survival in the teeth of catastrophe. Pi is a teen who drifts for 227 days in a lifeboat with a Bengal tiger. This tiger he rescued from the ship that tragically sank while transporting to Canada his family and the animals from his family's zoo in India. So Pi has to adjust to his grief over the loss of his family while also adjusting to this terrifying situation. He discovers in time that the things that he has to do to stay alive in the presence of that tiger, those things build into him the very courage and determination he needs to survive the larger ordeal, which is floating alone in the ocean on a lifeboat with a tiger. It's a metaphor for being equipped with faith while living with what we fear. It's common to find ourselves facing the challenge of living with faith in the presence of a tiger whose terrifying experiences of oceans of sickness or of storms of grief or starvations of uncertain employment or thirstings from loneliness or things that may seem a little smaller than that but still terrifying. A parent faces a tiger watching their child disappear behind school doors for the very first time. Or sometimes a tiger jolts you from sleep to unexplainable dread. Just like that. A tiger roars when you can't find a way to reach your loved one who you know is quickly spiraling out of control. Can faith coexist with a tiger? At one time, Peter, from this morning's text, could not keep faith and fear on the same boat. He had faith. You know, this shall never happen to you. That was Peter's faith. That was Peter's faith-filled response when Jesus had told him that he, Jesus, would be killed. Oh no, this will never happen to you. Faith. But Peter also had fear. Woman, I don't know Jesus at all. That was Peter's fear-filled response when a woman at Jesus' trial identified Peter as one of Jesus' followers. It's fear. Peter stood strong in faith in the absence of fear, but in the presence of a tiger, faith collapsed. You know, don't you, that faith does not take away fear. Neither has faith failed if you're still afraid of the tiger. We learn that from Peter of this morning's text, who is different than he was when he cowered at Jesus' trial. This Peter had learned to live by faith in the presence of a tiger. And it's worth taking a minute to learn from what he did when he was hauled before this judge for the terrible crime of healing someone. First, he started by reviewing the facts. What have I done? A man who couldn't walk now walks. No harm, no foul. You know, sometimes it's helpful for us to go over what exactly is going on in our lives. What precisely do we fear? And should we? Are we in the wrong? Have we been the instrument of our own misfortune? And if so, then the need becomes clear for us to reevaluate our behavior and the choices we make. But many times, a review of the facts will reveal that the matter before us is beyond our control and in the hands of God. And this is time for faith in the presence of the tiger. Secondly, Peter locates his faith. It is by the name of Jesus Christ that this man stands before you. Peter was in the same good spiritual place that we're in when we locate our faith in God, in Jesus' faith in God. The next time you're in the presence of a tiger, you might stop for a moment and say to yourself, remember that you are baptized. Our faith in God originates from no less than Jesus' faith in God. And that fact can help hold fear in check. And then finally, Peter knew that even tigers lack ultimate power. No other name is given under heaven by which we must be saved. It's with that kind of confidence that Peter's faith lived in the presence of many tigers. Something intriguing about Martel's story is that Pi, the kid, moved from plotting to get rid of the tiger to understanding that the tiger was the key actually to his survival. Now, I'm not lending support to that harmful old idea that God makes bad things happen to us to teach us valuable lessons. That notion comes from a mistaken translation of Romans 8:28. That appears in many of our Bibles and says, all things work together for good, implying that no things are really bad things. Tigers are not really tigers. They're really kittens. When you realize that God placed them in your boat for your own good. That notion can leave you stunned in the presence of a spouse's diagnosis. I mean, what could God be trying to teach us by putting a shooter in our school? What good should I expect after God causes my business to fail? Dear friends, God, who so loved the world that God gave the only begotten Son, does not put tigers in our boats. If that were the case, our need would not be for God, for a God who saves us from tigers. Our need would be for someone to save us from our God. Romans 8:28 properly reads, "In all things, God works for good." The Bible does not call tigers kitty cats. The tigers that get in your boat are real. But what Romans 8:28 affirms is that you will never find yourself in any situation that God is not also in with you. And you will always be able to recognize which things are the things that God is doing in that situation, because in all things, God works for good. Peter understood this. And later, after the authorities had released him, he met with others to pray about what to do next, and notice what he prays. "Now, Lord, consider their threats and enable your servants to speak your word with great boldness." He didn't pray for God to ditch the tiger. He understood that the tiger of fear and adversity would always be in the boat with followers of Jesus. What he prayed was that his faith might coexist with the fear, so that he might have boldness to walk as a child of God. I have a story that will make you believe in God. Both the old man and Peter make that promise. And then they both really tell the same story. It's the story of God with us in the presence of the tigers. And this is the word of God for the children of God. Thanks be to God. I actually want to invite you to join me in this affirmation of faith. We believe in God who brings forth life from death, joy from sorrow, blessing out of disaster, who meets us behind our closed hearts and speaks a word of peace, who is known in the simple act of breaking bread, gathering around a table, who never forgets our name, who feels our pain, who renews our lives from the inside. We believe in the risen Christ who did not hide his wounds so that we might not hide our own, who is present to us in our loneliness, our fear, our doubt, who embraced the hard questions, face death's door, and walk forward into every experience so we might know we have a companion on the way. We believe in the Holy Spirit, who is as close to us as the air we breathe, who inspires the church to be a beacon of light, an oasis of peace, and a fountain of joy, who gusts freely as the wind, touching souls, chasing away the blues, setting loose, and hallelujah, we shall live as a people of God. Friends, the peace of Christ be with you. And let us share with one another signs of Christ's peace, unless you have recently had the flu.
I invite our ushers to come forward as we prepare to collect our offering this morning. As we do that, let us pray. God, we know that you are with us no matter what challenges we face. We offer up our gifts in these moments, and we offer up our hearts to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
You can be seated for just a second. I know that, I don't know why I'm so emotional today. I know that there's not a person in this building who doesn't have some kind of a tiger in your boat. Some of those can feel relatively minor, like the tiger I'm feeling right now. We get on a plane in the morning, fly to Charlotte, North Carolina for 2 weeks of general conference. Some of those conversations and attempts to persuade and all of that kind of scare me to death. But we go with faith that God will bring good out of all of this, and that the United Methodist Church will land firmly on its feet and moving in a wonderful and positive direction. But I wanted to give a word today just to everyone with tigers on their boats, which would include all of us. And the first is just that God didn't put that tiger in your boat. The second is that if you're afraid of the tiger, that doesn't mean that there's something wrong with your faith. Tigers are scary and they're dangerous. And you'd have to be out of your mind not to feel fear. And the third word is, but when we get to that point where we've done all we can do and there's nothing left to do and everything is simply in God's hands, to have the kind of courage that we need to trust God, just to keep walking forward, even though we're afraid and even though there is a tiger in our boat, to have faith in God and to walk forward knowing that there's nothing wrong with our faith. The proof of the strength of our faith is that we're still moving forward and trusting God. So I hope that that will be a word of faith for you today. Let's sing together.
Since Kevin's going to be gone, we're going to say a little prayer over him that I'm going to ask if Annie will lead. And then we'll do our benediction.
Just come stand here in the midst of us. Father God, we send our pastor with love and support on this next 2 weeks that he's facing. He's a little bit anxious about this trip. It's something that he has been looking forward to for actually decades in a sense, but certainly this past year especially. And we just want him to go with our support, with strength, with courage and love, and we send him on his way. Thank you. Amen.
Confident of God's love, leave this place with courage and faith, knowing that God is at work for good in all things. Look for God in the goodness that you discover, and do all the good that is yours to do. Love God with all your heart, and the light of Christ will shine in all that you do. Go in grace and peace. Amen.